the schools. That is, schools that for three or more consecutive years have never made above a D or an F on our uniform assessment tool. Now, there are tens of thousands of students across the state of Georgia who are required by law to attend those chronically failing schools simply because of what their zip code is. The General Assembly agreed, and by the way, you got a constitutional amendment on the ballot, and those in the General Assembly here today can tell you, getting two-thirds of the House and the Senate to agree on anything is not an easy lift. But they did agree to that. It will be on the ballot this November. I would hope that you would become interested in that and that you would help us to make sure that it passes. Now, I know that there are those who would say, well, you're going to take away local control. Quite honestly, if somebody at the local level has not seen fit to address these chronically failing schools and the children that are required to attend them for at least three consecutive years and can't get them above or near or down on their scores, it's time somebody intervenes.
Right. Amen.
And for those who are opposed to the intervention of the state in that regard, the common question would be, well, what are you doing about it? What are you doing about it? If there are school board members who say, I want to retain local control, if they're on the Board of Education, they have the opportunity to do it in their school system, and hopefully they are. And the good news is that some of them are. I commend the superintendent of the Atlanta Public Schools for her initiative. She is making great strides in that regard. And I hope those of you who are in the Atlanta Public School System jurisdiction will encourage the board and her as they try to be successful. Nobody wants a child in a failing school. But if local jurisdictions do not address it, then it's time somebody did. And the state, I believe, can do that and can do it successfully. So it's important, I would hope, that you would see fit to help us in that undertaking. Now, there are other things that I could talk to you about, but I want to leave those discussions in more detail to our discussion that Dr. Lomax and I are going to have in just a minute. But let me tell you, though, what, as I wind up these remarks, what is happening in our criminal justice reforms. It probably is one of the most successful efforts that any state has taken to change the dynamic of the way we deal with the violators of our law. When I came into office, as I indicated to you, the prison population at that time was about 56,000. And I was told that you might as well be prepared. That prison population is going to increase by about 8%. And by the end of your first term, which was last year, you will have to have at least two additional adult prisons because you're going to have at least 5,000 more people in your prison system if nothing changes. I'm pleased to tell you that we are just slightly over 53,000 down from the 56,000, and that is almost 6,000 below what it was projected to be in 2010. So that's a good deal. One of the other things that has happened that I think would be of interest to this group in particular is that we have seen the nonviolent population in our prison system drop to about 14%. Previously, the percentage of nonviolent offenders in those expensive prison beds was exceptionally high, and that has been reduced. Another effect of the criminal justice reforms has been that we have seen about a 20% drop in prison sentences imposed on African-American offenders. That is a remarkable statistical change of direction, and I think it is a good sign, quite frankly. So, we're making an effort at the state level. I hope that you will aid us in these undertakings. I want to commend all of you for what you're doing to promote the importance of public education and education beyond high school. But the reality is that if we really want to reform our criminal justice system, we need to reform our education system. It will be the ultimate criminal justice reform. And that's why I believe these proposals, both the Opportunity School District and the implementation of the recommendations of the Commission on Education Reform, which I will ask the General Assembly to consider next year, are so important for the future of our state. You know, I wonder, as I watch television every evening, and I see the local news here in Atlanta, and I see this murder, I see this armed robbery, I see this hijacking of an automobile, and I see all of the other crimes that the television cameras seem focused on telling us about. And many of those who are the perpetrators are young people. I would say the vast majority are young people. And I wonder to myself, what do you think the percentages of those who are perpetrators of those crimes, what percentage do you think drop out of school? Unless you're on the high side of your estimate, I think you will be very, very wrong. Because you see, failure in school provides the fire that feeds the furnace of criminal justice and feeds into our prison system. So that's why these are so important. If we want to change the dynamic of our state, of our local communities, we need to improve educational opportunities. I'm committed to that. I thank you as voters of this state that you have given me the opportunity to do it now into my second term as governor. I pledge to you that in the remaining 2 years in which I will be governor under the General Assembly in its leadership, I will dedicate myself to continuing these propositions. It's a good thing when Georgia's named the number one state in the nation in which to do business, something that we take pride in the fact that now the third consecutive year of that designation. It is a good thing when we are recognized as the number one state in terms of meaningful criminal justice reform. I look forward to the day when Georgia will be recognized as the number one state in terms of educational opportunity for all of the citizens of Georgia. Thank you.